Thanks, everyone. So I'm Adish, third year PhD student in ETH Zurich, working with Professor Andreas Krause. And I'm going to talk about learning and incentives in human computation. So as we all know, human computation is a new paradigm that aims to fuse human knowledge and expertise with the computational power of the machines. There are a lot of interesting and successful examples of such systems. For example, a Galaxy Zoo, a citizen science project in which hundreds of thousands of volunteers across the world are helping scientists to annotate images. Mechanical Turk, a little bit different flavor because here the crowd or the workers are actually doing this work to earn money. Another kind of human-powered system, Stack Overflow, which is a social Q&A system. People can post questions or respond to questions put forward by other people. A little bit different flavor from the previous examples. Community sensing is another example of human-powered system, which actually involves more physical involvement of the people. So community sensing aims to build a large-scale, low-cost sensing network, for example, using devices, mobile phones, GPS trackers, which are held by people. And there have been prototypes to do air quality monitoring or build earthquake maps from this. And the last example that I'll put is made popular by smartphone apps or the social and gamification aspect. Here, people are using this application to learn languages, and their input is used behind the scenes to translate documents. So putting it all together, so the goal of our work is essentially to improve the effectiveness of such human-powered systems. And the two ingredients that we look at is machine learning and incentives, and the interplay of these two. So specifically, we focus on three directions of interplay between learning and incentives, and it'll come clear with examples. So looking at the first dimension, how can we use machine learning techniques to improve the incentives that we offer to the people? For instance, in Mechanical Turk, the monetary incentives are used. How are there algorithmic questions of unknown distributions, price, and utilities, as well as to design a payment structure, should we have more bonus or wages? Citizen science projects where the incentives are social contribution. However, we still want to make sure we basically have the maximal engagement of the participants. We can learn their expertise, match jobs based on the skills and the expertise of the crowd. Looking at the second dimension, community sensing, or for example, is used for information gathering, sensing. That data is fed into a machine learning application. Same for image annotation tasks. The data is fed into machine learning or information gathering applications. And for instance, the participants may not want to participate in a community sensing application because they may have privacy concerns and other issues. So how can we use incentives to actually improve the participation in such systems so that we can improve the data gathering, or we can get better quality data for machine learning applications? And in Stack Overflow, for example, the goal would be to maximize Q&A participation. And here, we may want to design incentives such as social badges so that the participation is maximized. And the third dimension is where learning itself acts as an incentive. Because it's human-powered system, so learning is a very powerful thing that humans that drives the human curiosity. So Duolingo is one example where people are actually using this system to learn. And from the other perspective, we can look at from the recruiter's point of view. They may want to hire some low-skilled workers, but then give them some training so that their effectiveness is improved. So teaching it is also an incentive from the recruiter's point of view. And so how learning and teaching can we effectively, how can we model the learning behavior of the crowd and design some teaching algorithms? So that falls in the third dimension. So putting this all together, we look into different problems that we tackled along different dimensions. We'll begin with these two dimensions. We'll specifically focus on a project of bike sharing system, where the bike sharing system may have imbalanced problems because of irregular traffic flows. And then we'll discuss how we can engage the crowd by giving them incentives to help us repositioning those bikes. And in the second part of the talk, we'll look into the third dimension where we developed models of crowd learning and teaching to improve their classification accuracy. So we'll begin with the first part of the talk of the bike sharing system. So bike sharing system is a new emerging paradigm of mobility, which is in getting popular in urban cities because it's fast and flexible. It gives a good alternative to the citizens compared to crowded transport. And the adoption is growing worldwide. So there are right now 700 cities, 800,000 bikes, which are being used throughout the world. And Boston metropolitan area has actually a very good bike system, Boston Hub Bay, which has over 140 stations located throughout Boston metropolitan, 1,300 bikes, over 10,000 registered users. So this is a typical user's pattern of bike sharing system. So let's say in the morning, we have some users from East Cambridge picking up bikes, going to downtown Boston, or going to Harvard, going to MIT. And what this would lead to is that some stations may get empty. On the other hand, there may be a lot of users taking bikes and going towards Harvard, parking the bikes there. And that station may get full. There won't be any free docks in that. So the imbalance problem is, because of this irregular flow towards a day, so some stations may get empty, some stations may get full. And if a user comes with a bike to a full station, he would be disappointed because he won't be able to leave the bike. And same for the other case. So right now, the bike sharing operators, they use truck-based repositioning. And what is done is throughout the day, the trucks are being deployed, which basically takes bikes throughout the city to rebalance the system. And this takes actually a big portion of their revenue as we've been working with actually a real bike sharing operator. And it's actually not easy to deploy the trucks, for example, in afternoon when there's a congestion. And this also goes against the green concept of bike sharing system. So the key question that we ask is, how can we engage the users of the system itself to steer their behavior in a different way so that we can solve this repositioning process problem? So,
do you know roughly what the bounds are in the number of bikes that are if they double the number of bikes in the system, right? Or they double the number of parking spaces for bikes in the system, is that going to...
Yeah, well, it's not like a self-sustainable system in a way. Like, it may solve the problem in short time, but as the system would grow, as more and more users would grow, and a lot of these systems are growing rapidly, actually. It's also actually difficult to have very big stations, because these stations are really located within... because these are actually upcoming new systems, so it's difficult to allocate a station with 50 bikes. So normally most of these stations are around 20 bikes, 30 bikes, and bigger ones near maybe main station or universities. So it's around 15 to 20 bikes. That's kind of a limit because of the space issues and stuff.
Have you looked, is there any literature on this in the area of car rentals? Because car rentals have had this problem for decades, right? Everyone wants to a rental car to get them to the airport, but no one wants to leave a rental car in a small town.
Right. So one thing in the car rental is, so for example, the car sharing systems where we can, or Zipcar system. So over there, there isn't a flexibility of where to drop. So or you have to pay that expense beforehand. Like if you want to pick a car from here to there, you may have to pay a higher price to drop it there. So that is already taken into account by the central authority because you are paying upfront to take to a place which is already overcrowded. And you may already have to give a discount when you take to a less crowded place. So I think the main problem here comes because of the flexibility. So users can take bike anytime, bring it anywhere, so they don't have to do anything upfront. So this is one example of how we can engage the users. For instance, a user taking a bike from MIT going towards East Cambridge. Now what we could do is he has to drop a bike over there, and there's an empty station nearby. So we could somehow, if we could tell him to drop the bike at that empty station, so he would have to basically drop a bike there and then move towards his destination, walk towards his destination, then that would add up one bike to that empty station. And similarly, somebody coming from Sport Avenue to MIT, we could ask him to pick a bike from Harvard Station, which is filled up. That would reduce one bike at that station. So this is an example of what we think about balancing, engaging the users to balance. So there have been some incentive schemes in context of bike sharing system, not many. So there's the one existing scheme which is used is in Paris, Belive. They use a non-monetary incentive. So if a user is going uphill, they offer him 15 extra minutes. However, this is like a static and it's not monetary. It doesn't depend on the system of the status of the system. So our approach is we actually provide monetary incentives. The money actually goes into accounts of the users. The offers are dynamically computed based on the system status. We see what stations are problematic at what time, and then we decide which stations to offer. And we based on a machine learning framework where we can listen to users' feedback, adjust the prices over time with respect to the underlying distribution of those users. And our goal is to maximize the overall quality of the service of the whole system, which essentially here is captured by no service event. And no service event is if I'm taking a bike and I want to drop to a station, that station has no empty docks. That is a no service event or kind of a disappointment for a user. And similarly for picking up bike, if I go to a station, that station is empty. That is a no service event. So the overall architecture of this system is as follows. So we have rental stations. So we actually, the rental stations here correspond to operated by Mainz, in Mainz, Germany, by MBJ Right, which is a public transport company in Germany. So this is the stations, bikes, and all the hardware components. And the BSS infrastructure that we're dealing with is operated by Electric Field, which is a software company in Zurich that we are collaborating with. And that tracks all the software parts, for example, managing user accounts, tracking who is picking the bike at what time, tracking the status of the stations, as well as doing future forecast for the truck reposition. On top of this, we built two components. The first is reasoning about the user model, thinking about what exactly would be his reaction to incentives, what kind of would the users be willing to participate in this kind of system, what is their distribution for walking distance or price, and then designing the incentive scheme, which would basically compute what stations to offer bonus, how much incentive offer to provide, listening to the user feedback, and then also interacting APIs to interact with the BSS infrastructure, for example, tracking the status of the stations and tracking the user accounts to transfer money or to check if user who took the offer actually completed it or not. And on top of all this, we have a smartphone app through which it interacts with the user. It would basically, the user would look up where to go, and it would provide an alternate station with the price. And user can accept it or just ignore it and go to his default station. So looking at the user model, the three main components, so the three characteristics of a user that are important here are the location, the current location of the user, the minimal cost, the underlying cost that user would like to receive as incentive to participate, which we assume is unknown and is sampled from an unknown distribution, and the maximum walking distance that the user would be willing to walk. And the model is simple as this. User, LU is a location. There's a fixed distance within which user is willing to walk. That's, let's say, a 500 meters distance. Within that, user is willing to walk to go to an alternate station for a cost, fixed cost C. And beyond that, user is not willing to walk. So it's a very simple model. And the way we infer these three properties are, so the location, that comes from the smartphone app that we through which we interact with the user. The price is something that we learn by interacting with the user via mechanism. And the maximum distance is based on the survey data that we did with the users of this system. Looking at stations, so the three characteristic properties of a given station is what is the total capacity of that station, let's say 20 bikes it can hold. The current number of bikes at any time, let's say at this time there are 15 bikes in this station, and a future forecast. So the infrastructure, BSS infrastructure, provides us this forecast in based on the past history that within next 1 hour, how many bikes are going to come in or going to go out based on some approximation. So we, based on that, we define what we call near empty and near full stations. This is, let's say, so the forecast is done for 2 hours window. This would mean that within this window, this station may get empty. Within this window, this station may get full. These are the stations that we would like to make offers for. So this is an illustration. So there's a near full station. This is going to get full within this time hour window. There's a user that comes in to pick a bike. By default, we assume he'll go to the nearest station. Then the incentive scheme would look at his walking radius. Then you'll see all the problematic stations within that radius. In this case, the action is pickup, so it'll look at all the stations which are near full within that radius. And it'll make an offer for those stations. And the user can pick one of those. If there are multiple of those green ones, it'll pick one of those. So the next part is about deciding how much to offer. So this is based on the pricing mechanism that we call dynamic BBP UCB. So the main constraints here are basically, the way system operates is it operates in time slots. So every 2 hours, the operator allocates some budget. Let's say 15 euro for this 2 hour window. It says you can use that for your repositioning policy. And we have some approximation of the number of users we will interact with in this time hour based on the forecast, because the offers we would make would depend on how many users are going to come that we can interact with to change the behavior. So the mechanism that we used in our work is based on dynamic version of BBP UCB, which was actually designed for a fixed budget and fixed pool size. So I'll discuss this mechanism next, and then we'll see how we kind of plug back into our dynamic setting. However, I would also say this mechanism, pricing mechanism, is a black box. So all the components are kind of a black box. In a way, we could change user model to something else, change pricing mechanism to something else. So looking back into this mechanism for design for fixed B and N, so this is from our last year WWW work. So I'll illustrate. So let's look at the case where the cost curve is known. So there's no learning process involved. There's a fixed B budget, fixed pool size, and the cost curve is known. What would be the price that we would like to offer? So ignoring the budget, if there's no budget, the number of accept, the utility here is the number of people who would accept the offer if the offer is made. And the x-axis is the price. So this would just be proportional to the cumulative distribution F. So cumulative distribution essentially reflects what is the probability of a user to accept a price at a particular point. And looking on the other side, if there is no constraint on the pool size, and then the number of offers that would be accepted would be dictated by this curve 1 over x. And this just simply means because the pool is infinite, eventually, somebody would take up an offer. It's just as the price, as we offer higher price, the number of acceptance, number of offers we can make will decrease. So, putting these two constraints together, the optimal price would be given by this intersection of these two curves, which is for a fixed price mechanism. This is the truthful price that could be offered. Right? So, the next question is, how could we use learning, how could we reason about learning this curve if this is not known to us? So what we could do is, so thinking about this curve as a probability of an acceptance at a particular price, we could make an offer, let's say 0.7, to a user, and based on his feedback, whether he accepts or not, we'll get some idea about the estimate, what is the probability estimate at that particular point with some kind of confidence level. As we make more and more offers of a particular price, our confidence bits would shrink and means would get updated. So we can make different offers at different price that would basically allow us to get the estimates of this curve with some level of confidence. So we basically would end up having some approximate curve with some kind of confidence. And this our mechanism is kind of inspired from connection to multi-armed bandits, where we think of each action as an arm, where the rewards are associated with the course. Hmm? So the actions are the arms here, and the utilities or the rewards are associated with the probability of acceptance at that particular price. So as in multi-armed bandits, so what we could do is offer different prices to learn about this curve, or we could just any point stick to the knowledge of our curve and exploit that knowledge.
Be a different curve for every time of day and every curve station, right?
Ideally it would be, yes. In this work, we assume actually one curve, but we could also reason about a morning curve and evening curve.
Or over several days, it's going to remain.
Yeah, right. So now, putting the budget constraint back into picture, so what we want to do is we want to explore, learn different prices under this budget constraint. So putting back this explore and exploit paradigm, so what we could do at any time is offer a price just to explore, that is to reduce the confidence bits at that point, or just use the current estimate given by that green line, intersected with the budget constraint curve, that would be the exploitation or the greedy step at that point. And what we offered in this case is given by that intersection, which is using the optimistic bound or the upper confidence bound over our price curve intersected with the budget constraint. And that is inspired from this UCB algorithms in multi-armed bandits, which basically using the optimistic bound of your estimate to offer. And so this implicitly combines exploration and exploitation by doing that. However, the budget constraints add some complexity to the analysis of this. So I'll give you a quick snapshot of the results without going much into details. So inspired from this online learning, this has been basically our goal is to minimize the total regret or minimize the utility that this mechanism would get compared to the optimal fixed price mechanism. And the total regret bound for our mechanism comes out to be this, which is essentially logarithmic to the problem of the parameters of the problem. And the main goal in this kind of problems is to essentially design mechanism where average regret goes to zero. Right? And that essentially means that as the learning would continue, the system would converge to the optimal fixed action. So this is about the theoretical results, skipping the details here. But putting it back into this dynamic setting. So that mechanism, we designed it for fixed budget and N. In our case, basically the day is split into 2 hours windows. At every window, we get a budget and some estimate of the N from the future forecast. And we run our one instance of the mechanism for each of those windows. However, the main thing here is that the learning process can continue across the different time windows. So the B and N parameter changes at every time window. The learning learning continues, which allows us to basically still get faster convergence by operating our mechanism. And as per the question, if we would like to use different F curves, so that would just mean that we are running different parallel instances. So maybe one for morning and one for evening. But they're kind of running across multiple days over time. And there could be also one different for weekend, for instance. So the learning continues, and essentially the system is able to learn from the past interactions as well. So this allowed us to kind of take that black box, put it in, adjust to the dynamic setting without going into much complication. So,
in your Explore exploit work, how do you discretize the space, you know, to deal with the number of actions?
So we actually discretized based on something that we normally make offers to okay. Based on currency.
Essentially. Scale to dollars or something.
Right, right. For example, 5 cents, 10 cents. We won't make like 6 cents, essentially. So what we did next, so we did this survey on the in Mainz to the users of bike sharing system that, and we asked, the survey was essentially to understand their rental behavior. For instance, for how long do they use the bike sharing system, what kind of contracts they have, are they students, do they use it for work or leisure? As well as we also introduced our incentive system. We said we would like to deploy this kind of system for experimental study, and what would be your reaction to such system? So for instance, this is an example of a question where we asked them, how much distance would you be willing to walk to pick a bike at an alternate station? So these are the results, the data that we got for this particular question of walking distance. So the question was, what is the distance you would like to walk? So on the x-axis is the distance is increasing. On the y-axis is the percentage of users who are willing to walk that particular distance. Just to clear, it doesn't go to 100% because there was also an option, I'm not willing to walk. So essentially 15% said, I'm not willing to participate while walking. So essentially, we can see that after 500 meters, there are not a lot of people who are willing to walk after that. And so this data we actually used, we computed the fixed, we took an average of that and we used that fixed walking distance radius for the whole population. So this is how this data was used for us. The second question was about their cost. And here the question was, if you have to walk around 15 to 20 minutes, what is the price that you should be given to you to accept that offer? So there was a big chunk of users who have here 0.5. So this saturates at 80% because 20% of them said they are not willing to take this offer.
Said like 30 seconds ago, what this was for was you said this was 15 minute walk or what was the?
So 15 minutes.
Okay.
So that corresponds to roughly 500 meters kind of radius that we had in the previous one.
Okay.
So we actually also did different threads of the surveys. We did around 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. There wasn't a lot of difference generally. So at some point, we just basically start seeing more of this, we're not willing to participate if we increase up to a certain point. But within this range of 10 minutes to 20 minutes were more or less kind of same. So here, the way we use this data, so first of all, we use this for our offline simulations. This is essentially the price curve that we wanted to learn. And we also use this data for cold start problem because in our deployment study, we're not going to have a lot of interactions because it's a small scale study. So we also use this as a cold start problem where we can do runner mechanism offline on this data and then kind of deploy it. So putting this together, so next step, what we did was before we could actually deploy this kind of system, we had to kind of have some convincing results for the company. So we did a lot of offline simulations.
I'm just getting a little further on that part. So I'm wondering if there's a way that you can get around having to use the survey data for how long people want to walk. Because so I know, like for me, if I was just asked a question on a survey of how much money would I take to walk 15 minutes, I'd be like, well, you know, I wouldn't be able to give you a good answer. Mm-hmm. Through the app, you should be able to like see where people are going. And,
right. I would say. Right, so this data, in fact, is not important actually for the running of the mechanism because this is more of for walking distance is actually something that we used, but the monetary part is not important. It's more of to do offline simulation of the results.
But I thought you give people the
But this is something that we could, the learning mechanism would just learn
So I guess what I meant is that it seemed to me that you're using the fact that people's reports on the surveys did not change very much when you changed the amount they walked from 10 minutes to 15 minutes to 20 minutes.
Uh-huh.
It sounded like you were using that a little bit as a justification for kind of having a fixed price rather than like a varying.
So we are, in a way, we are using one price curve underlying distribution for this fixed for the distance. So we are not essentially using, we are not using different curves for different distance. So in fact, in our work, the distance, walking distance that we used, we basically considered all the bikes within this maximum fire radius to be equivalent. A more complex variant of that would be to using different F curves for different distances.
Then you can just choose the one that gives
you the most safe. Right. We did some experiments where we actually, there were two learning components involved using a more complex machinery where we basically could reason about learning distance and price simultaneously. But finally, what we used actually for the system was where we didn't play around with the distance and just use the cost as an unknown thing in the system.
So the people who get those data, they only get it after they already take
No, so they basically use the app to look up a bike, like, and then at that point they are essentially offered this right? And at that point, basically, when they click yes, that I'm taking this offer. In fact, then we track their behavior for next few hours, so they actually have to perform that action. So it could also be somebody took an offer and then didn't go there. So we actually, behind the scenes, we track if they actually did the action. And once they finish the action, then the money is transferred.
So I just want to clarify, maybe I missed it. So all this is really great on the supply for filling up at these stations.
Mm-hmm.
What are your thoughts about the cost of the firm, like on the demand side? Like what, shouldn't the budget be defined somehow by how expensive it is to have an empty station?
So basically, the cost that we are using is so roughly on an aggregate, it costs roughly 2.5 euro to move one bike from one station to another.
Okay.
So
you're backing that just straight from the trucking cost?
Right.
Okay.
That's essentially the cost that over an year, the revenue, kind of the spending of the company for the truck repositioning.
I mean, some of this is like, part of the reaction to it also just be that future customers would have to walk the same distance. So I wonder if you can use these same models.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Either the company could truck these bikes around or the next customer would just have to walk 10 blocks instead of this guy, right?
So yeah, I mean, basically here we are saying like, we are giving the money to a user to essentially move the bike for us, right? Instead of truck doing that thing.
Okay, never mind.
We will discuss it offline.
Yeah.
So actually, related to that question, it seems I've gotten slightly confused about how the pricing relates to how full a station is.
Mm-hmm. Right. So we just have a notion of we just have a binary notion. It's either near full, near empty, or they are normal. So basically, they just fall in two categories.
So if it's near full, you want to pay people to take bikes. If it's near empty, you want to pay people to drop off bikes.
Yeah. But you could also reason about how critical the station is.
So the point is, you said before that you have estimation of sort of future demand.
Yeah. So that's what we use to quantify what is near full or near empty. So based on the current status, so right now we know there are 15 bikes out of 20, and future forecast says in next 1 hour, 10 bikes are going to come here because there's a lot of incoming traffic. So that defines our near full status. So with that time, we start going to engaging users to pull out the bikes from there. your question is clarified, actually.
I think that like, you don't need to have like the binary condition with the radius. I think that for any, even if people have varying prices and on the radius for whatever function, like even if it's not even a monotone function, we could extend that.
Right. So basically, the other one is walking distance, and the third is essentially adding the critical level of the station itself. So all this could be one complicated curve that could help us quantify the final price that we are offering.
Right. So for multi-parameter settings, people have like different costs for different distances.
So next, basically we did the simulation studies. So we did simulation studies with the MINES data as well, which is private data actually. But there's also a public data from Boston Hubbay, which was released 2 years ago. That was actually released for visualization challenge. So they shared all the data, every information about every ride, and the challenge was to do the visualization. This data. And we use that data actually for our simulation. So what we did was we built the BSS simulator, kind of the simulator of how people kind of move around to simulate their processes. So the first result that we look at here is, so we are on the x-axis, we are varying the budget that is allocated to different kind of repositioning policies throughout the day. And on the y-axis is the quality of service. And we'll look at different repositioning policies. Just a side note, so there is an underlying trucks that is running here for 3 hours, and then additional budget is allocated on top of that. In the next slide, I'll also comment about this complementary thing, like why we are adding new positioning on.
What is quality of service in this case?
So the quality of service is essentially so total events minus no service events. And no service is if I have a bike, I want to pick up a bike from empty station, so that is a no service event. So the first is basically based on the trucks, adding more budget to the trucks, how would it improve the performance of the system? Then we look at three fixed price policies. So on the bottom, we see a min price, which just offers 10 cents as a minimum currency of the system. And the second mean price is the mean price of the population. And the third one is this fixed price, the P star that we looked at if we knew the pricing curve. And then we ran our mechanism. So that is performs very close to off fix. And reason for that is each point here is actually a 30-day simulation. So the mechanism can run learn very quickly, even within 1 day. It can learn the true price. And then over 30 days, so basically, performs nearly same. So even for 1 week, it kind of converges. After 1 day, it kind of converges to off-fix. Because the system is essentially running in a continuous fashion. So this looks good here in terms that there's a good amount of gain compared to the trucks. The second thing that we actually looked at is just doing a budget trade-off between trucks and incentives. So on the x-axis is just trucks alone. On the right side is just incentives alone, and on x-axis we are varying how much budget is allocated across these two domains. Right? What we see here is that there's a good complementary effect between these two. And one way to think about is maybe the trucks are doing a global repositioning more at a macro level, whereas the incentives are doing more micro and more dynamic level to kind of move the bikes around. And the third thing that we looked at was the participation rate. So basically, in such a system, it'll take a while for users to kind of start accepting incentives or kind of, if we have a phone, to kind of start using that app. So on the x-axis here, we are essentially varying the number of users who are participating in the system. And the trucks remains constant because that doesn't depend on the participation of the users. So the good point from here is that what we see around 20 to 30% of participation, the incentives can essentially kind of help over the trucks. So this.
Just to confirm, you see
define user profiles based on, based on the survey, right?
Based on?
Based on the survey. Like, how do you define user profiles? Like, if they will, if they will accept a certain payment or not, or something like that.
So we, these users are actually not even the same who participated in the survey.
Yeah, but like, there's, you will have to define a user profile within your simulation, right?
Oh, in the simulation, yes.
Yeah.
Right.
You define that based on
based on the survey. Yeah.
And this participation rate thing is like, as I come in, I flip a coin with this probability, and I participate. Or
this is more like out of the full system, we only can provide incentives to 30% users. So rest of the users, we cannot interact with them because they don't have a smartphone average. So next. We did an experimental 30 days deployment in Mainz, Germany. So there are some qualitative results from that, some interesting insights. So this is a simple spatial distribution of the accepted offers. So here the bigger size essentially is the more number of accepted offers there. So this is more of, we see accepted offers are higher in the more dense areas. I think this is kind of quite intuitive. So this station and the old downtown of Mainz, where the dots are concentrated. Second thing we looked at is how kind of users interact with this kind of system. So for here on the x-axis we vary the number of accepted offers by the users. On the y-axis the percentage of number of users who accepted that. So what is interesting here? Most of the users accepted 4 to 5 offers during this trial phase. Well, there were few very active users who were actually using this system to actually to earn money. So that was interesting because there may be some users who may actually want to, like in a Mechanical Turk, there may be actually users who want to earn money by doing this repositioning.
So with those really active users, did you take a look at the data to see if they're actually like helping out the system, or
if
so I'm just wondering with these very active users, mm-hmm. If they're helping out the system, or if there might be an issue with the incentives whereby if you aren't like penalizing people, mm-hmm. for taking a bike from an empty station, if there were like two empty stations right next to one another.
Huh?
And perhaps your system solves this. The one thing I could do is take bikes like back and forth,
right,
between them. Is that not allowed in the system?
So that is not. Yeah, that is not allowed. So these are actually the offers which were actually useful, and these were the offers where they accepted the offer and then they executed it, because we actually tracked them behind the scenes. If they pick up a bike, and then they actually put it somewhere else, where they were asked to put it.
Okay, and so you're saying that there's something. That is specifically hardwired in, sort of to say that if I take a bike from station A to station B, mm-hmm. then you're not going to then show me an offer if I pick up a bike at station B and offer to take it to station A.
Right. So this data we have actually analyzed properly to kind of see what if there was something wrong going on or not. So these were properly executed.
So relatedly, there's still an attack. Because, well, I don't know how that system works, but in Hubway, it's very easy to take two ID cards from, like, I can take mine and someone else's, and then just ride back and forth between an empty station and a full station, crediting my account whenever I go one way. Right. I'm just curious whether you can tell from the data whether they're potentially more complicated attacks.
So, but that moving around is still helping us, right? Or if not?
No. It's just creating more work for yourself. Right? You just take artificially emptying several subway stations.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So you send out to it because they know that they are going to do
it. Just one comment on this. So one thing I would also say is like, I think right now the system was in a, we actually knew all these users and they subscribed up saying like we would be happy to kind of do this experimental study. So I think right now is not there that is being attacked, but
once we do,
so there would be more challenges involved in actually when we actually do it for the general public.
So this is people who signed up for the trial? It's not everybody in the city?
No, this is the signed up trial. So it's like a beta test phase for a small set of users. Put it in the survey.
So just briefly on this point, like, this is really interesting. I mean, if you had a distribution of total rides, not even accepted offers, mm-hmm. it probably looks like something similar. So I think benchmarking that would be useful.
All right, the total ride in the system, yeah.
And also, I mean, can you back out an envelope cost of like what their wage rate is, these guys, the super users?
So the last one here got around 40 euros.
40 euros?
40.
Total over the month?
Total over the, yeah, it was around, yeah, over a month, got 40 euros.
Right, how much, do you know how much time they were on the e-bikes, right? So.
Right, so I don't have the time statistic actually, how much time they actually spent doing this. We have it in the behind the scenes, but essentially we should be able to quantify per hour how much they are. Right. I don't have it right now. So the last one, so this is more of qualitative check. So here basically on x-axis you're seeing the distance that they had to walk, and on y-axis how many times that offer was accepted when they were asked to walk this much distance. So this kind of qualitatively matches with the survey data. And the final one, which is more interesting, is actually the hour of, so on the x-axis here we check how the incentives that were accepted by people vary over day of the time. And this is aggregated over 30 days. So what is interesting here is like there's a peak around afternoon. And that's an interesting time because that's exactly the time when the trucks are not being used. So truck repositioning normally happens in the early morning or in the late afternoon. So this is qualitatively, it's good to have peak round afternoon, which is also the crowded time for the users using system. So to put it together, so here, to summarize in few lines, basically, what we looked at is a bike sharing system. It's a kind of new, little bit different from the standard crowdsourcing kind of applications, but it's a human-powered system, and our goal was to engage the users to help improve, optimize the system itself. And so we did a lot of simulation studies, survey studies, and deployment, which had good promising results. And as a next step, there's a plan for doing a larger scale deployment on more users in next few months. So in the second part of the talk, we have 30 minutes, so maybe we'll have to rush a little bit on this. So what I'll focus is on the third dimension, which is about learning and teaching. And here basically, this is basically inspired from the classification annotation tasks, which is essentially a lot of that data is being used, fed into machine learning algorithms. And the goal here is how can we improve the annotation by teaching or training those workers or the participants. Any question the previous, or should we maybe go on this because we don't have much time at this point? Then we can come back to the questions on bike sharing again. So here, so this, yeah, as I said, like this is really inspired from the image classification, which forms a big chunk of crowdsourcing systems right now. And there's a Galaxy Zoo, eBird, lot of medical domain applications where participants are tagging, annotating the images. And a goal really is to how to improve the accuracy of the labeling task of such participants. And one common method that is used is to add redundancy, basically giving the same task to multiple annotators and then use some kind of machinery reasoning about the accuracy of the annotators or simply doing majority voting to come up with the answer. And some control measures are added, such as gold standard questions to remove noise or spam from the system. Here we explore a totally orthogonal direction where we look into can we actually teach those annotators to improve their level accuracy. So this, and our work is gonna be focused on binary image classification. This is one example, it's also a running example. We'll look at some results on this. So there's the goal here is to classify whether a woodpecker species is endangered or not. So there's one, in this data set, there's one endangered species, And there are two of them which are not endangered. And basically, the annotation task is they're going to look at the images. They have to tag whether it's endangered or not. So the goal of our work is how can we pick a small set of images, show them to the workers, participants in the training phase, with the hope that their accuracy would improve in the long run. Right? So I'll illustrate some of the aspects on the synthetic data set. It's much easier to explain. So what we have here is binary classification tasks, just two species. There's a Bespula and Weevil. And the goal is to classify if it's Bespula or not. So basically, there are two features which distinguish Bespula from Weevil in this. So one is the head body size proportion, and second is the color contrast. And this essentially forms our feature space. And then we have a small set of examples that we can use, which are labeled, given to us, that we can use to train the workers. Right? So this forms a feature space and the teaching set from where we can pick. Then, so we don't know the hypothesis that is being used by the crowd, but we can reason about. So we have to, as a teacher, we have to kind of reason about what is the hypothesis space. In this case, for example, there may be, let's say we assume they are linear hypothesis. So there could be a class of workers who have some cues, maybe Bespula have color contrast. So they're just using feature two, ignoring feature one. There could be another class of workers, let's say, ignoring feature two, right? There could be workers who are wrongly using feature two, but only using correctly feature one. And the goal is to teach them to this RAD hypothesis, basically show them some examples so that they are as close as to this RAD hypothesis, which is using both the features correctly. So before going into detail about the teaching, I'll like to differentiate it from active learning, which is much more studied problem. So in active learning, there's an optimization problem running on the learner. There's an oracle or environment which knows the true hypothesis H star, but learner is trying to learn that. So what learner does, or the algorithm active learning does, is it picks an example somehow smartly. It sends it to the environment or the oracle. Oracle provides a true level. Based on that, learner would update her belief about H star. And in this active learning or normal machine learning problems, the goal is to how to select those few examples to be able to learn H star. Whereas in teaching, the optimization problem is sitting on the other side. This is sitting on the teacher who knows H star. And the goal of the teacher is to pick some examples, show it to the learner, to steer learner towards H star. And the uncertainty or the complexity here arises because teacher doesn't know what is the current hypothesis of the learner. Whereas in the active learning case, learner knew what is my current hypothesis, but learner didn't know the H star. So it's kind of inverse problem. Okay. So given this, let's look at what optimal teaching would mean for this kind of task. Right? So one thing is clear, the teaching, optimal teaching, or the notion of teaching, how we would teach would depend on what our model of the learner is. So essentially one key theme here is also to kind of design a model of the learner and use that model to teach. So there's this classical approach, which has been from 90s, Goldman and Kearns, where they used a very simple model of the learner, where the idea is that the learner is noise-free, or that operates in this way, that there are eight hypotheses in here. The blue one is the right one. And as learner would see an example, it would just eliminate the hypotheses which are inconsistent with that example. So very simple learner. Right? So it would see another example. It would eliminate the hypotheses which are inconsistent. Those two would go away. It would see one more example, this would go away. So in this case, the optimal teaching is simply set cover. Right. However, this strategy, as we'll see in the experiments as well, will end up picking examples which are too difficult because it assumes the learners are too strong, or they can learn very quickly. So in case of Weevil, Bespula, these are the examples that it would pick up. And actually, they make really no sense because they are just too confusing, close to the boundaries, aiming to eliminate the hypothesis. And we'll also see from the experiments, the workers actually get confused by seeing these examples because they don't give the right cues for them to learn. So our model of learner is, we think maybe the, as a human learner, we're not going to eliminate hypotheses. We have some kind of stochastic nature about how we reason about the hypothesis. So our idea is that when we see some example, the hypotheses which are inconsistent, we're going to reduce the weight of those hypotheses. So we maintain some kind of probabilistic notion over those hypotheses. We're going to reduce their weight. As we see more and more examples, we're going to keep on reducing the weight of those hypotheses. And this is something what we call as noise-tolerant learners and or something we call robust teaching. To fully formalize the model of the learner, these are the four things. So there's a prior distribution of the hypothesis from where the learner starts. And it does some kind of multiplicative updates over the hypothesis. So as it sees an inconsistent hypothesis, it's going to reduce the weight of those hypotheses. It does a lazy move. If I'm on a current hypothesis, I see an example on which my current hypothesis agrees, I don't change anything. I stick to that hypothesis, but I still change the weights. However, when an example disagrees with my current hypothesis, I'm going to make a jump. And that jump would depend on what my probability distribution is at that point. To illustrate with an example, so the blue is the right hypothesis. The red dot is where I am right now. I see one example. My current hypothesis agrees with that example, but I'll update the weights. I see another example. I'll update the weights. However, my current hypothesis disagrees with that example, so I'm going to make a jump now. So my jump would depend on distribution that I have over this hypothesis. I'll draw a hypothesis sampled from that distribution. So given this model of the learner, the next question is, how can we formalize a teaching as an optimization problem on this? So the goal really is we want to set a small... Yeah, right. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's just a probability. There are two different aspects. One is changing the weights. One is jumping to some hypothesis based on the current distribution.
So I see that I'm wrong, but I could jump to something that's also wrong.
In this model, yes. Yeah. Okay. However, the weight of those hypotheses would be less, so the probability to jump there would be low. So the goal is to pick a small set of examples, A. And we want to quantify what is the error of the learner after seeing those examples. Right? And the error of the learner could be quantified as follows. After seeing examples, A examples, what is the posterior of this learner over the hypothesis? And error rate associated with each of those hypotheses. So this is simple. So this is after seeing examples, this would be the error. And the optimization problem would be something like, I want to reduce the error below epsilon. How do I pick a small set of examples to reduce the error of the learner below that epsilon? So this optimization problem is hard by simple reduction to stochastic set cover. So this basically now we'll see some tricks of how to work around this and how to design our teaching policy. So the main key idea that we use here is actually, so first trick is simple. Actually, we change minimization problem to maximization. Just reduction in error, so that's simple. But the main trick that we use actually to work around, to come up with a nice policy is we use unnormalized posterior. So instead of the posterior distribution over the hypothesis that is used to quantify error, we use unnormalized posterior. What is good about this unnormalized posterior is it has a smooth properties because these numbers just go down, whereas the posterior could go up and down. So this gives us a nice handle to deal with this surrogate objective. So we basically what we did is we designed another objective that has a nicer properties, allows us to design some policies on top of that. And then we'll operate our policy, we'll design a teaching policy on this surrogate objective, prove some bounds on this, and then we have to link those bounds back to the original objective. So this new objective function that we designed satisfies some molarity properties, and then we can design a simple a greedy teaching policy that basically operates on FA. And this is the policy that we call strict, which is similar teaching for crowdsourcing classification. So without going into much detail, so I'll state the quick results and then we'll go to the experimental results. So the first thing is we say that strict, what is the error bound on strict? So what we prove here is that by running a policy on this surrogate objective, we are still able to get a near optimal error bound on the actual function. So basically, this theorem can be stated as this. If the goal is to get an error below epsilon, the number of examples that are needed by strict teaching are kind of the same order as that needed by any other teaching policy which achieves same order of error. Right? And the proof goes along, as I said before, so proving the bound on surrogate objective and then linking the bound between surrogate objective and the original objective. And the second thing that we prove is it's not just sufficient to maximize the surrogate objective, it's actually also necessary. So if the value of surrogate objective is too low, the error is going to be too high for the learner. And then for a special class of hypothesis space, under some additional assumptions of how the examples are distributed, we prove actually some stricter results of how the error goes down as we pick the examples using this policy. So coming into back into some interesting experimental results. So what we did was we did our experimentation on Mechanical Turk workers. So we recruited the workers from Mechanical Turk, and then they were split into different groups based on what is the length of the teaching and based on the algorithm that was used to teach them. And then the workers were given a fixed payment for participation and then some bonus at the end. And the protocol is something like this. We are given an image set or the teaching set that comes from a label data that for which we know the true labels. And then we obtain some kind of feature space and hypothesis space. So this is not known to us, so we have to somehow reason about what could be a good hypothesis space that could reflect workers. And then we interact them one by one. We show, give them a question, ask them to label. The workers would say yes or no, and then we'll give them the right feedback. And the hope is they can learn from this. So first, let's look at the results on Wewill and Bespula. So basically here, there are we compare strict compared to two baselines. One is the one which picks examples randomly. And the second one is set cover, which is basically using this noise-free learner model, which just eliminates the hypothesis. On x-axis is the group on which how many examples were given to them in the teaching phase. And on y-axis is the test error. After the teaching, they were asked to annotate another set of unseen examples of, and their performance was measured on that test set. So there are a total of 780 annotators, which essentially means each data point here is an average of 60 workers. And also to illustrate this idea of the complexity of teaching, so as we saw in the set cover case, it kind of picks up very confusing examples. Whereas strict kind of picks examples from which if we just kind of look visually, we get some intuition of what those features are possible. Second, we did experiments on this real world data set that we introduced before. So there's one endangered species and two of them are not. And we want to show some examples and hope is that they would learn. So here, the main also interesting question is how can we come up with some feature space and hypothesis? So what we used here is, so we use the Caltech UCSD data set where each image is annotated with 300 binary attributes. So basically, for example, given a picture, is the crown color red? So it's a binary attribute. So there are 300 binary attributes for each of those images. So that gives us a very large scale feature space that we could possibly use. We could have used some other feature space as well through some other method. So this is what we used here. And then for hypothesis, we used a set of linear hypotheses, a sparse set of linear hypotheses. And our intuition is that the workers may be using some of those features, some cues, not all of them, As a human, I'm not going to look at 300 features, but I'm going to look at some of those features to decide whether to annotate positive or negative. So our hypothesis actually had only up to three non-zero weights, and a weight of -1 would mean I'm using a particular queue, but I'm using it in a wrong way. And one would mean I'm using a particular queue, but I'm using it in the right way. So this is the results on Woodpecker classification. So same setting, two baselines. Here we had a total of 520 annotators, which means each data point here corresponds to 40 workers. So here strict achieves essentially up to 20% lower test error. And again, we see the set cover could actually perform worse than random because it picks examples which could deviate them in the wrong direction. So to summarize this part, basically, this has been motivated by the classification and image annotation tasks on crowdsourcing. And the main work has been to come up with a simplistic model of human learning process and design and teaching policy that can essentially teach those learners. To summarize, so what we looked at is generally inspired from human computation and crowdsourcing applications, different algorithms that could essentially help improve the effectiveness of such systems. Most of the time we try to design algorithms which have nice provable guarantees, as well as real world experiments using survey search studies, deployment, or through online workers. Thank you. Actually, so we had to do a lot of last-minute engineering tuning, like even essentially to make sure the offer that is accepted by user is actually done. I mean, it's not like the user accepted an offer and then he kind of disappears and picks up bikes from another place. So I think dealing with these kind of small issues, interacting with the real world infrastructure team. So that has been quite challenging actually for us. And then also convincing the company to do this survey studies. That was also challenging because they didn't want to kind of do this sending out mass emails to their user base because it's quite risky for a company to do that. But overall, they have been quite supportive as well, and they actually also wanted to. So actually, one interesting thing I would say is like this Mindstrade, the company with whom we were working, so a lot of their program managers, and they were actually very like kind of champions from Germany who actually do bike riding and stuff. So they're actually very much into this, which helped us kind of get through into get these things done.
Have you In your system, you definitely looked at monetary payment, monetary incentives. Is there any study of using like badges or other social incentives for getting
people to bike sharing?
Yeah. Because then you don't need permission from the company. You just make an app that keeps track of badges and you and bicycles. And
I think the monetary part is, I mean, we'll probably have still same issues. Because we still need to deal with the company's infrastructure.
Why?
Because we are still, we need this status, like future forecast. We need user accounts.
Yeah, you can keep track of that data yourself. I mean, so there are all these third-party apps that interact with every single bike system to get the data of how many bikes are available. Like, there are four apps for Boston that tell you where the Hubway bikes are.
I'm not sure if there is any public data available, for example, this system or like most of the European bike sharing systems, because these are operated by this infrastructure team that I said, BSS infrastructure. So they are managing a lot of these bike sharing systems in Europe, for example, and they have access to this data, like who is taking bike and who are the users who are engaged in. So if we would have to actually deal with these real users, or get system status or get user accounts, so we had to kind of go into their system to. So I think the monetary part is not important. It was more into really dealing with the users. So we would still have been happy to design non-monetary incentives, like giving them extra minutes, for example.
I mean, given that there are all these apps that have the data, I don't see why.
But I'm not sure, like, why do you think the apps have data? But these
because you pull the app up and it tells you stuff that uses the data. That's why.
I mean, this is the first time actually we have deployed an app for this system, in fact. They didn't even have a smartphone app before. So it was kind of, the users just have to go there and pick up a bike. But for instance, future forecast, right? So you're essentially, I think we are going into a place where we are trying to simulate what is the status of the system, or what is the,
right? Do you agree that these apps have access to the current status of the system?
Maybe in Boston Hub Bay, I'm not sure.
So in Chicago, in Boston, in New York, everywhere I've ever been that's got a system, has got mm-hmm. an app that has access to the thing, then the app's a third-party app. It's not uh-huh. provided by
okay.
the organization. Every single one. Paris also.
Yeah, but okay. the granularity at which you could track interactions is way mm-hmm. less. Like, for example, you wouldn't be able to see if somebody completed a particular journey. You could do some like vague inference about, like, you know, there were seven.
But if you're distributing badges, you need to, oh, so the point is, if you take a bike and deliver it somewhere, you can't see if that was that person.
Exactly, like that's what they have, that's the granularity they have with
super
that data.
Low probability, right, that like a bike would arrive at, because you have the GPS at the point you're running around.
Yeah, but I mean, like, just like the idea of like, so yeah, so I think Hubway has like an API that you can basically query and say how many bikes here at the given time, but I mean, without any information, you have to admit that the granularity of data that you have inside the company is way better than the granularity you'll have, you know.
It is better.
Yeah.
But second best might be better than nothing.
He has first best, though.
Yeah.
For a town in Germany that nobody here's been to.
I think this bike sharing operator is normally dealing with other bike systems as well. But if there's a third-party app available, I think there's a potential to use that as well. But I think there would be some points where we may need more information about the user, how he's interacting. But there's definitely potential to use that.
But I was curious about the first part of the question, beyond, you know, the data or whatever, do you know of any studies that have looked at non-monetary incentives in a similar, you know, real
right,
world
so
move around sort of system?
Most of the non-monetary incentives have been giving extra minutes, but they're more of more allocated to days, let's say on weekends or to the special stations.
So one thing that I'm a little worried about is you're using a constant cost function without implying the weather, which seems to be
right.
the determinant.
Yeah, I think this is quite simplistic. So I think there's very easy way to kind of extend this to, right. So we didn't actually tackle it here in the first kind of beta test.
So has the company signed on to adopting this as like a longer term solution to distributing bikes?
Yes. I mean, as a next step, they want to do a little bit larger scale experiment. But this is also a risky strategy because it's kind of going outward slowly. But they want to go in this direction for sure.
But so internally, they're happy about the outcomes, not just because they collaborate with, you know.
Right, right, right. So they actually, they want to kind of, they have allocated budget, for example, to kind of develop a better app and deploy at a larger scale. So they want to kind of push forward in this direction as well.
Do you have a sense of how this would work if you instead charged people something to take, let's say, the last bike at a station, as opposed to, or there are fewer than five bikes, then they have to pay something to use.
Right, so that is another aspect where basically you have to essentially change the price, as is done in like a car rental kind of system. So that's another strategy to look into. Where basically when we are doing car reservation, we have to essentially, the price is decided based on how crowded that station is. And here as well, so most of the bike sharing system is more like the price is constant, as far as I know, in the, like it's more like a swiping and taking the bike for a fixed time. So I don't even know if the prices are kind of changed over time for a particular station.
Did you do this 2 months in summer or in winter?
Sorry?
The pilot that you run was in
Oh, this
summer,
was in July.
July, okay, middle of summer.
Okay. Yeah, I'm optimistic. The rest of the mission will be taken offline because we have some people that want to go now to the theory center. But the good news is that Adisha is around here all week. So we're going to set up a schedule for everyone to meet up with Adisha. So I strongly encourage you guys to do it. So let's thank Adisha one more time.
Thank you, everyone.